can, let's turn our Bibles to 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 2, please. Let's turn our Bibles to 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 2. Toy, how we doing? All right. Glory to God. 1 Kings chapter 2, I mean chapter 17, verse 2 through 16. Hallelujah. And the Bible says, then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, get away from here and turn eastward. Hide by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. And it will be that you shall drink from the brook. And I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. I commanded the ravens to feed you there. So he went and did according to the word of God. For when he went and stayed by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan, ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning, and ravens brought him bread and meat in the evening. And he drank from the brook. And it happened after a while that the brook dried up, because there had been no rain in the land. And then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, arise and go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. So he rose and he went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, indeed a widow was there gathering sticks. Mm-hmm. And he called to her and said, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. And she said she was going to get it. And he called to her and said, and please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. So she said, as the Lord lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in the bin and a little oil in the jar. And see, I am gathering a couple sticks that I may in and prepare for myself and my son that we may eat and die. And Elijah said to her, do not fear. Mm-hmm. Go and do as I have said and bring it to me. And afterwards, make some for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord, thus says the Lord, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run out until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. Watch this. So she went away and did according. She did according to the word of God. She did according to the word of Elijah. And she and he and her household ate for days, and the bin of flour was not used up. I said the bin of flour was not used up, nor the oil run dry, according to the word of God. Whew. Oh my gosh. I felt that word right there. God said, I commanded the ravens to feed you. God said, I commanded the widow to provide for you. He told the widow, your oil shall not run out. Mount Zion Tabernacle Church, God sent me this Sunday morning to tell you, in 2021, our oil shall not run out. Glory be to God. Our oil shall not run out. But, there's a but in it. But you got to put God first. But you got to put God first. But you got to put God first. Watch this. Elijah, who was a type and shadow of Jesus, told the widow, watch this. Elijah was a type and shadow of Jesus. Nate, do you remember on the Mount of Transfiguration when Peter And John and James went to the mount. And the Bible says that they saw Jesus, and they saw Elijah on one side, and they saw Moses on the other. and then what happened was the three disciples said, "Oh my gosh, let us go make three altars." And Jesus said, wait. Moses, get back. Elijah, get back. Because at this altar, Jesus. That's it. Because if you needed somebody else other than Jesus, God would have sent them with him. Jesus. So here's Elijah, type and shadow of Jesus. And Elijah told the widow woman, "You must put Jesus first. Make my cake first, and your oil will never run out." Look at somebody and tell them, God has commanded a blessing on us. Look at them, tell them. Say, God has commanded a blessing on us. All right. They ain't talking loud enough. Now look at them and say, but you got to put God first. But you got to put God first. Mm-hmm. Mount Zion, something big is coming in 2021. Something big is coming in 2021, but we got to put God first. We got to put God first. Could it be that many of us owe God an apology? Could it be that many of us owe God an apology for jumping to conclusions about what God has allowed to happen in our lives in 2020? Could it be that some of us owe God an apology for jumping to conclusions about what God has allowed in our lives in 2020? Did we miss that God was calling us to set things back in order? You see, because in 2020, God was calling us to get back to putting God first. You see, in 2020, God was calling us to put Jesus back in your house. In 2020, God was calling us that everybody would begin to work in the children's education. In 2020, God was calling us to take back over social media. In 2020, God was calling us to stop taking your local church for granted. Could it be that we misread the challenges in our lives in 2020? You see, God has a very clear plan for us, a very clear and a very loud plan for us. God said in Jeremiah 29:11, he says, "The plan I have for you," he said, "the plan I have for you is for good and not evil." He said, "The plan I have for you," "is to prosper you." He said, "The plan I have for you is a plan of future and of hope." You see, God's plan for us is clear and it's loud. But before God's plan comes to fruition, there's some work God has to do in us. There's some work God has to do in us. So that we can grow in a new level of faith. And more faith can flow from us. Oh, let me show you. Let's go to Romans chapter 1, verse 17. God is trying to get more faith to flow from us. Watch what the Bible says. The Bible says, "For in it the righteousness of God is revealed." Your righteousness is revealed, watch this, "from faith to faith. For the righteous shall live by faith." Let me tell you what he's saying there, Tyra. He's saying that means that the more of what God wants to do in our lives is revealed from faith to faith. I said the more of what God wants to do in our lives will be revealed through faith to faith. Oh, glory be to God. Hallelujah. God has set up our lives that we are moving from one level to the next. God has set our lives up that we would move from one level to the next. In fact, God says, the steps of a good man have already been ordered by me. The steps of a good man have already been ordered by me. But the journey, you see, we get it twisted. Angie, the journey is a stair step. You see, we hear that God has ordered our steps. God's blessing us. Woo-hoo-hoo. We think the journey goes like this, but that's not the case. You see, the journey with God is a stair step. You see, God takes you to a high peak, and then he takes you down a valley. And then after you go down the valley, he takes you to a higher peak, a step. Valley, peak. Valley, peak. You see, that's how God moves when he's taking us from faith to faith. Well, look at Job's life. Look at Job's life. Job was in the peak of his life. And then all of a sudden, Satan went and had a conversation with God. And God allowed Satan to touch Job's body. Now Job was in a peak, but Satan touched his body. And all of a sudden now, Job is experiencing a valley. Job is experiencing a valley. But this was not designed, to bring Job down. This valley was designed to take Job to a higher peak. This valley was designed to take Job to a higher peak. Watch this. And to give me and you hope in our valley. And to give, you see, the Bible, when you read the Bible, he's talking to them, but speaking to us. So when he took Job's life and took him from a peak to a valley and to a greater peak, he was telling me, hey, stop tripping if you're going through it, because I'm going to bring you out greater than you went in, because that's who I am. Oh, I need somebody to hear me in here today, because I'm preaching the word of God. Job was in a valley. But you see, Job ends his life better than he started his life. Job ends his life better than he started his life. Job said, I heard about God, but now I know God for myself. I heard about God, but now I know God for myself. Mm-hmm. You see, God has ordained us that our latter days shall be greater than our former days. God has ordained us saying our latter days shall be greater than our former days. You see, he does it by moving us from faith to faith. But we must understand that God does his best work in the valleys. God does his best work in the valleys. Watch this. In the valley is where God is shaping us and growing us for the next peak. Mm-hmm. Rick, God is shaping us and growing us for the next peak he has planned for us. Watch this. Watch this. Watch this. Watch this, Rick. The worst thing that God can do is to elevate you to a peak that you don't have valley experience for. The worst thing that God can do is to elevate you to a peak that you don't have valley experience for. Oh, glory be to God. You know, listen. We would struggle at a peak that we don't have faith for. We would struggle at a peak that we don't have faith for. It is the valley that strengthens your faith. It is the valley that strengthens your faith. Can I tell you something? You never, watch this. If you ever been in a situation and you had a God, if it had not been for the Lord on my side moment, Then you know that when you had a moment that God should not be on my side, but there was God who showed up and I never would have made it if it wasn't for Jesus. See, when you have that kind of experience in the valley, you have that kind of experience in the valley, it strengthens your faith. Watch this. When Elijah, the scripture said, was a powerful prophet. The scripture says that Elijah was so powerful that he called down fire from heaven. The Bible says that Elijah was such a powerful prophet that he killed 450 prophets. Yes, he did. But before he operated in his power, God had to take him through a valley. You see, God sent Elijah to the brook Cherith. God sent Elijah to the brook Cherith because in the brook Cherith, there was a drought. In the brook Cherith, there was a drought. Watch this. As a matter of fact, Cherith means cut off. Cherith means cut off, to be cut off, because there was a drought. How many of you know that in 2020, God dried some stuff up and God cut some stuff off? Come on, somebody. But God will always take care of his obedient kids who put him first. But God will always take care of his obedient kids who put him first. Oh, glory be to God. Before God released Elijah into his powerful ministry, he sent him to the brook Cherith. Before Elijah went and prayed and brought down fire, before he started laying hands on people with a double anointing, before he slayed 450 prophets, God sent him to his valley. God sent him to the brook Cherith. You see, God sent him to the drought place. God sent him to the place that he was cut off. Have you ever been in a place that didn't look like what you thought it should be? Have God ever sent you to a place that just didn't line up with the picture you had in your spirit? Have you ever found yourself in a plan that was God's plan, but it just didn't line up with your plan? Glory be to God. But Elijah was obedient. You see, Elijah said, God, it don't have to be my plan. I'm doing what you say do, God. God, if you say go here, I'm going here. God, if you say it, I'm saying it. God, if you say give it, I'm giving it. God, if you say serve it, I'm serving it. God, Elijah went where God sent him. Elijah went to the Cherith Brook. And because he was obedient, God sent him a raven to feed him in the middle of a drought. Now, let me explain something to you. If you know anything about birds, you see, birds, come on, Jacob. You see, birds, they only go out and get food. Birds don't bring food back. The only time a bird brings food back is when he got kids in the nest. Why do you think God used a bird to feed Elijah? Because he wanted us to know that he was going to feed his kids in the nest no matter what's going on outside. Come on, somebody. I need you to understand that when you put God first, when you're obedient, God will feed you no matter what's going on in the world. Glory be to God. As a matter of fact, God sent Elijah to the brook Cherith, where there was a drought and nobody was eating and nobody had water. And here comes this bird feeding Elijah. What was God doing? God was strengthening Elijah's faith for his big assignment. Without faith, God, Elijah couldn't have went to rocks and water and false prophets and say, get out of the way. Fire, move. He wouldn't have had the faith to call on fire from heaven. He wouldn't have had the faith to slay 400 prophets. God had to build his faith up, and he sent them to the valley. He sent them to the brook Cherith, where there was a drought, where there was cut off. And God sent a raven to feed him so that he would know that no matter what's going on the outside, I'm going to take care of my kids on the inside. And Elijah's faith in the valley began to grow. Elijah left the Cherith brook knowing that I shall lack no good thing. Come on, somebody. If you are an obedient Christian putting God first, I need you to know you shall lack no good thing. Woo. Hallelujah. 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 Let's talk about the widow woman. Let's talk about the widow woman. Because the widow woman, scripture says, was in Zarephath. Well, Zarephath means refining. So right off the bat, God says that this situation is about refining the widow woman and probably Elijah too, because the woman was in Zarephath. You see, the widow woman was in the valley because she felt like her situation was bad and she had ran out of options. You ever been in a situation where it got so bad you had no more options and you said, it's whatever. Whatever happens, what happens, it's whatever. You know, because you was in a pickle and you had no other options. This woman was in a valley. She had no other options. She was in trouble. Her options had ran out. She was in a valley. But here comes the man of God. Here comes Elijah. Here comes the type and shadow of Jesus. Watch this. Let me show you what he said in Kings, 1 Kings. Here comes Jesus in 1 Kings 17:13. And he's talking to the woman in the valley. He's talking to me and you in the valley. Look what he says. Elijah said to her, "Do not fear." Right there, Elijah's talking to her faith. He's saying, "Do not fear." So he's speaking to her faith. He says, look, do not fear. Watch this. Go. And do as I have said, watch this, but make me a cake first. Now, he's talking to her faith, and he's telling her faith, put God first. Because when he starts telling her about her fear, he's really speaking to her faith. And he's saying, faith, put God first. Watch this. God was giving her a choice. Watch this. Where my ladies at? Here's this woman, Mariah, and this man shows up, and he says, can I get some water? She says, sure, we got plenty of water. She on her way to get water. And all of a sudden, he yells to the door, and bring me some bread. She turned around and popped her neck. Oh, wait a minute. You know how women get when you ask them for something that they shouldn't be giving you, or you ask them for something you shouldn't be asking them. She started, I could just see her not popping her neck, and, you know, I don't know how to do it, and just doing her thing, you know, because wait a minute. How you going to ask me for some bread, and all I got is a little bit? All I got is a little bit. Anybody in here working with a little bit? Let me show you what she did. You see, she didn't know, but I'm going to let you know, she didn't know she had water, so she had the Word of God. Because the Bible says the Word of God washes our mind. So she had water, she really had the Word of God. She had oil, she had a little bit, but that's all you need. She had the Holy Spirit, because the oil represents the Holy Spirit. And she had bread. Now, bread represents Jesus. Jesus is the bread of life. Here's this woman. She had, glory be to God. She had the Word, she had the Holy Ghost. Hey, and she had Jesus. All she had to do is make a decision to believe God. I want to talk to somebody in here today who has the Word, who has the Holy Spirit, who has Jesus. Are you prepared to make a decision to put God first? I don't know. God might be telling you to serve on your off day. What decision are you going to make? I don't know. God might be telling you to sow an extravagant seed. I don't know. What decision are you going to make? Because here we sit, we got the Word. We got the Holy Spirit, and we got Jesus. And Jesus said, now you got options, because God is waiting on you. He don't do home evasions. Now, this woman, all she had to do is make the right decision. So she chose to believe God. And when she made the right decision, God says, since you put me first, since you, Mount Zion, you put me first, your oil shall not run out. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Faith to faith is a process that must put God first. Faith to faith is a process that must put God first. Watch this. God had already commanded a blessing on Elijah's life. The blessing was already registered. The Bible says that my gifts are without repentance. Blessing already registered on your life. It's already registered. God already commanded a blessing on the widow woman's life. They already had it. We already got it. We just have to follow the steps that God has ordained. We just have to follow the steps that God has ordained. Listen, if we're going to prepare for the peaks, if we're going to prepare for the peaks, if we're going to be prepared for what God is doing in 2021, we must know that there will always be a process. If we're going to prepare for what God is doing in 2021, we must know that there will always be a process. God has given us a pattern of such. God's pattern is this: out of Egypt, through the wilderness, into the promise. Let me do that again. I don't think they heard me. This is God's pattern, and God does not change. Out of Egypt, through the wilderness, into the promise. That's God's pattern. That's God's pattern. Watch this. Watch this. You see, our Egypt was 2018 and 2019, because that's where we begin to trust in our way and not God's way. Because if you look back, we thought we was doing okay, and we began to start doing things our way, not checking in with God, seeing what his way was. In 2018 and 2019, we were in Egypt because we were doing things our way. And God said, hold up, wait a minute, we got to put some Jesus in it. And so then God brought 2020. And when he brought 2020, that's when God took us into the wilderness. He took us into the wilderness. You see, then God said, okay, now 2020, you went into the wilderness. But in 2021, Amanda, we go into the promise. Let me say it again. Out of 2018, out of 2019, into the wilderness of 2020, onto the promise of 2021. Come on, somebody. I'm speaking to you prophetically from the Lord. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Whew. Our wilderness time that was in 2020, God cut some stuff off and dried some stuff up because he was trying to get our attention. He was trying to get our attention. But our promise is in 2021. Watch this. God brought Jesus out of heaven. Took him down 42 generations. And when he brought Jesus out, he took Jesus into the wilderness. The Bible says he went into the wilderness for 40 days. And that's where he was tempted. Then God brought him out of the wilderness into his earthly ministry. You see, God's example still stayed the same even with Jesus. Let me show you something in Luke chapter 4, verse 14. Because God brought Jesus out. He brought him out of his wilderness. The Bible says the Holy Spirit let him in. So I'm telling you, it was God. The Bible says the Holy Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness for 40 days where he was tempted. But then he brought him out where Jesus began to work miracles. Look what the Bible says when Jesus came out of the wilderness. The Bible says Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit. Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit. Jesus returned from the wilderness with power. But can we be real, Carl? Let's just be real for a minute so nobody get it twisted. Jesus is God. I need y'all to hear that real clearly, like, so you know where your shepherd is at. Jesus is God. Yeah? Yeah. Am I right about it, Melvin? Jesus is God. So now Jesus never really was out without power. So what was happening here? Jesus was being an example for you and I. Jesus' whole life was to bless us through being an example for us. So what Jesus was doing was showing us that in order to go and operate in power, we must go through the process. Jesus was showing us, in order for us to operate in power, we must go through the process. Where are my Pentecostal people at? Oh, glory be to God. Hey, on the day of Pentecost, yes, sir, on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Ghost fell, and they received power from on high. Listen to me, they received so much power from on high, there was one of the evidence of speaking in other tongues. But I need to tell you something. Before they received Holy Ghost power on the day of Pentecost, they had to wait 40 days. What was the 40 days? The 40 days was their process. Was their process. You see, before Jesus pulled them out of a life of disobedience, you see, Jesus pulled them out. Didn't he do it? He walked all down the street. Rick, come here, fisherman. You ain't no fisherman no more. You with me. Come here, tax collector. You ain't no tax collector. You with me. Come on, barber. You ain't no barber no more. You with me. What does that mean? That my barber should stop being a barber? No. He stopped saying that I'm a barber. He starts saying I'm a Christian who happens to be a barber. Oh, come on, somebody. I need somebody to hear me today. Jesus pulled them out, and then he took them in. And then he released the disciples in power on the Holy Ghost. Come on, somebody. I'm trying to help us. I'm trying to help us. Glory be to God. Listen to this. God will intentionally take you through the process, because the process is preparing us for our blessing. God will intentionally take us through the process because the process is preparing us for our blessing. Watch this. One of the reasons why the church operates in such little power, one of the reasons the church operates in such little power, because we got too many people in the body of Christ that's not willing to go through the process. Now, I got to talk real to you because I'm a real preacher and I'm trying to get us to revival. One of the reasons why the church does not have the power that it should is because we got too many people inside the body of Christ that's not willing to go through the process. You see, because when you really go through a process, you learn real worship, Shayla. You see, Frank didn't teach you worship. The trouble did. Come on, somebody. When you think back about it, you became a real prayer warrior when you went through the process. You see, the process will make you a real prayer warrior. Let me show you what the process is. Can I show you? Watch this. Let's look at Matthew 16:24. I want to show you the process, because not everybody is willing to go through the process. Let me show you the process. The process is right here. Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, he will deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. That's the process. That's the process. Look, watch this. Watch this. The process, watch this. Watch this. The process is to pick up your cross. To pick up your cross is to deny yourself. To deny yourself is to put God first. Let me say it again. The process is to pick up your cross. To pick up your cross is to deny yourself. To deny yourself is to put, get the cross, man. Let me show them, because they don't see it. They don't see it. I got to show you the process. I got to show you the process, and I got to show you the power. I got to show you the process, and I got to show you the power. Watch this. When the cross was stationary, it was the process. It was an addition sign, because at the process of the cross, God was adding us to Jesus. You see, the process, while the cross was stationary, was addition. So the process was adding me and you to Jesus. So then when we picked up our cross and we began to walk with it, Eric, now you see the power from the process, because now the addition turned into a multiplication sign. So that's the power. Now you begin to be multiplied when you begin to walk with your cross. Do you see it? You see, there is a process. And then there's power when you come out of the process. Because when you pick up your cross, God begins to multiply your life. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. We got somebody back there who want to be saved. Hallelujah. If they don't want to be saved, they might want to be evicted. Now they can make a choice. Hallelujah. But when we take up our cross and we walk with it, now we walk in the power of the process. When we take up our cross and we walk with it, now we walk with the power of the cross. Glory be to God. Because the addition sign becomes a multiplication sign. Let me tell you something. God says, those who are obedient, watch this. Those who are obedient, meaning those who put God first, God will multiply you. Those who are obedient, meaning put God first, God says those are the people I multiply who come out of the process. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Tyra, take me to Deuteronomy 7:13, please. Let me show you the process of multiplication. Now, this is in Deuteronomy when God is speaking about the benefit and the process and the power of being obedient, the power of putting God first. Look what the Bible says. God says, when you put me first, when you pick up your cross and walk with it, God says he will love you. When you pick up your cross and walk with it, God says he will bless you. When you pick up your cross and walk with it, God says, and multiply you. You see that? God will multiply you when you put God first. Some of us are missing a supernatural increase because we won't go through the process or the valley. Some of us are missing our supernatural increase because we won't go through the process or the valley. You see, your process will involve a Brook Cherith situation. You see, 2020 was our Brook Cherith situation. It was our Brook Cherith situation. Let me tell you something, Nate. Most of us, well, really all of us, in your process, going to have to go through a Brook Cherith situation. I'm talking about a situation where God gets you all alone, where he cuts off everything else. It's a Brook Cherith situation. The reason why God has to take all of us to a Brook Cherith situation because the first thing that has to happen in all of our lives, there needs to be a private transformation before there can be a public manifestation. Let me tell you that again. There has to be a private transformation before there can be a public manifestation. So God has to take us all to a Brook Cherith. Come on, somebody. 2020 was not pretty, but it was preparation. Sometimes what you go through may not be comfortable, but it's preparation. Look at Joseph. God took Joseph from the pit to the palace. Anybody in here ever been brought from the pit to the palace? I don't know about y'all. Y'all look real holy in here. Y'all kind of quiet. But let me just tell you something about the pastor. You see, because God came and got me from the mud. I was so deep in the mud. Come on, I'm going to tell the truth about it, Keith. I was so deep in the mud, he couldn't recognize me. He had to wipe some stuff off first. Is that him? Oh, my God. Is that really him? Get him out of there. But had to hose me down so he could recognize who he was saving. You see, he came and got me from the mud. And I'm good with that. He took me from the pit to the palace. I'm telling you today that when God takes you from the pit to the palace, he gives you the kind of faith. When God takes you from the pit to the palace, ma'am, he gives you the kind of faith that you can look the devil in the eye and say, what you meant for evil, my God will turn it around for my good. Oh, come on, somebody. What you meant for evil, God will turn it around for my good. I'm living proof. Watch this. Joseph had to be sold into slavery. If he didn't get sold into slavery, he never would have made it to Potiphar's house. If he never would have made it to Potiphar's house, he never would have went to prison. If he never would have went to prison, he never would have got to the palace. Oh, come on, somebody. You see, when you look back over your life and you see the things that weren't easy, you got to know that was preparation. That was preparation. You see, our Brook Cherith of 2020 was God trying to get our attention. God was trying to get our attention. Because in 2021, God needs our undivided attention. In 2021, God needs our undivided attention. God has something big for the church. But he's saying, I need you to focus on me. I need you to focus on me. Oh, God, glory be to God. God took us through 2020 to teach us something about our relationship with him. God took us from 2020 to teach us about our relationship with him. Let me tell you something. Until Jesus is all you need, until Jesus is all you have, you'll never know Jesus is all you need. Until Jesus is all you have, you'll never know Jesus is all you need. So God had to take us through 2020 and shook up everything. He shook up everything. He shook up the 401k. He shook up our jobs. He shook up our finances. He shook up our church. He shook up our relationships. He shook up the schools. He shook up everything but Jesus. Jesus is the only thing that cannot be moved. Until you're in a situation that all you have is Jesus, you won't understand that, look here, I grew up in a single-parent home. My mom raised me and my brothers. The whole life, I watched my mom struggle. But my mom was a godly woman. And so I seen my mom oftentimes praying. And I said, Mom, what you doing? She says, I'm going to the only thing that we have. And I said, oh, really? She said, but if Jesus is the only thing we have, son, that's all we need. Come on, somebody. I'm trying to help us today. Have you ever been in a situation where all you had was Jesus? I mean, you was crying late at night. 3 a.m. You didn't even want to call nobody because you didn't want to wake them up. And you didn't want them to know I'm still going through what I'm going through. So I couldn't tell nobody because it's late and I've already bugged them and it's still going on. And I'm almost ashamed because I still shouldn't be going through it. And then all of a sudden, Jesus shows up and he tells me, I'll never leave you. And never forsake you. Jesus shows up. It says, if you put me first, I'll pull you out. You see, Jesus shows up. And when Jesus shows up, he lets me know that if that's all I got, that's all I need. If that's all I got, that's all I need. Watch this. Let me show you something. Hold on, Frank. We ain't ready yet. Hold on in 1 Kings 18:4. Woo! He's trying to send me there. He's trying to send me off. Glory to God. We ain't ready yet. 1 Kings 18:4, I love that. I love that. That just takes me back to the old Pentecostal days. We got to get us a B4, a Hammond. A B3, he said. Look at 1 Kings 18:4. Look at 1 Kings 18:4. I want to show you something about Jesus. If he's all you have, he's all you need. Let me show you something interesting in Scripture. Watch this. Watch this. The Scripture says, Keith, for so it was, while Jezebel, watch this, massacred the prophets of the Lord, Obadiah, a man, watch this, took 100 prophets and hid them, put 50 in one cave and 50 in another. Okay? Now, when he put them in the cave, Keith, he fed them bread and water. Why did God even tell us this? You see, because now you have some prophets who are scared of the same thing. Elijah was scared of Jezebel too. But here these prophets, in their fear, begin to trust in man. And when they start trusting in man, Keith, man gave them bread and water. But Elijah said, I'm going to trust the Lord. I'm coming out. I'm going to the cherub brook. And when Elijah went to the cherub brook, God fed him water, bread, and meat. What was God saying, Keith? God was saying that if you trust in man, I'll give you the basics. You see, man can give you the basics, bread and water. But when you trust in God like Elijah did, then you get bread, water, and meat, abundance. Do you see that? Glory to God. Do you see that? That's the Bible. That's the Bible. The difference between the natural and the supernatural is God. The difference between the ordinary and the extraordinary is God. But we're going to have to put God first. In 2018 and 2019, we begin to trust in our provisions. We begin to watch our provisions. And some of us, we felt like, okay, these provisions have come about because I've been faithful. And maybe it was. But you begin to focus on the provision and not the provider. You see, in 2018 and 2019, we begin to focus on the provision and not the provider. And God said, wait a minute. So he sent us into 2020, and he sent us into a brook cherub. He sent us into a drought. He cut some things off. He shut some things off because he says, we got to get back to trusting in the provider. Glory be to God. If I'm going to send you into 2021 and you're going to walk into your commanded blessing, you You're going to have to stop trusting in the provision and start trusting in the provider. I come to tell you today, prophetically, that in 2021, God has commanded a blessing on the church. In 2021, there's something big coming to the church, but we got to put God first. Oh, come on, somebody. We got to get back to putting God first. What are you talking about, preacher? I'm talking about trusting Jehovah Jireh for your provision. Mm-hmm. Come on, Frank. I'm talking about trusting Jehovah Jireh for your provision. I'm talking about trusting Jehovah Shalom for your peace. I'm talking about trusting Jehovah Rapha for your healing. I'm talking about trusting Jehovah Shalom for your peace. I'm talking about trusting Jehovah Nisi for your protection. Mm-hmm. Is there anybody in here willing to trust God? I'm talking about trusting Jehovah Sitkanu. Mm-hmm. Trusting Jehovah Sitkanu for your righteousness. Oh my God. Is there anybody in here today that wants to get back to trusting oh Elohim? I'm talking about El Shaddai, God Almighty. I run to a strong tower where I shall be saved. I'm talking about trusting, getting back to trusting El Shaddai, God Almighty. God lifted up high and mighty. Oh, but we got to get back to putting God first. Hey, when I get back, David, to putting God first, I don't have to go to God talk about please, 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 God. Mm-mm. I go to God with a you said down in my soul. Anybody got a you said down in their spirit? When you go to my Father, you don't got to go to him what he said or what she said. You go to God about what he said. You see, because my God said, my word shall never return void. So God said in Genesis, I'm going to bless you to be a blessing. God said in Exodus, I'm going to take you to a land of milk and honey. Anybody got a you said down in their soul? God, you said, wait a minute. God, you said in Deuteronomy, I'll be blessed in the city and blessed in the field. I'll be blessed coming in and blessed coming out. God, you said, I hear God with a you said down in my soul. God, you said in Haggai, my latter days shall be greater than my former days. I'm talking about the blessing on us in 2021. If we'll put God first and get back to a you said God, get back to believing God, get back to standing on God's word. Oh my gosh, I feel a Holy Ghost in this place. God, in Isaiah, God, you said if I would be obedient, I would eat the fat of the land. Oh God, you said in Psalms that you took pleasure in my prosperity. Oh God, you said in Malachi that you would open up the windows and pour out a blessing that we don't have room enough to contain. I'm talking about 2021. Our God has commanded a blessing on the church, but we got to get back to serving God and putting him first. Every word that comes out of your mouth ought to be God, you said, not what your neighbor said, not what the bishop said, not what the hater said, not what internet said, not what the politician said. God, you said. The Bible says in Luke, God said, if you give, I'll give back. Press down, shaking together, running over. God, you said in Philippians, my God will supply all of my needs through his riches and glory. God, you said. You said in Ephesians that you will do exceedingly and abundantly beyond all that I ask. I come to tell you this Sunday morning, Jack, God is preparing a table for the church in the presence of the enemy. God is getting ready to send a blessing on the church. God is getting ready to send power down on us. We got to put God first. Oh, we got to put God first. Ooh. I just heard God in my spirit told me to explain to you about the revival that's coming. Watch this. I told him in first service. I just heard God say, tell you, the last revival is coming. Watch this. Watch this, Miss Hanson. At the first revival at Azusa Street and in Florida and Pensacola, right? The revival was from the outside in. What are you saying, preacher? God was touching bodies with signs and miracles. He was growing back limbs. Tumors were falling on the ground. They were literally sweeping up tumors off the ground. What was God doing? God was bringing the unbeliever to the church through signs and wonders. That was that revival. But God said to me, when he was telling me about the revival, he said, but this last revival, Keith, he says, this is going to be worked from the inside out. You see, this last revival, God is coming to work on the body of Christ, not the unbeliever. What God is doing in this last revival, he's coming to the church and begin to mend our hearts and minds so that we would be able to carry what he's getting ready to put on us. This last revival, God is coming to the body of Christ, and he's working from the inside out this time. He's working on our hearts and he's working on our minds that we'll be prepared to carry the blessing that he's sending now. He's preparing a table for us in the presence of our enemies. Do you believe it today? You got to put God first. Do you believe it today? You got to put God first. Do you believe it today? You got to put God first. Do you believe it today? You got to put God first. Give God glory in this place. Come on. Let the roof come off this place. Let God know he's first. Give God glory. Let him know he's first. Let him know he's first. Let him know he's first. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo. Come on up, ushers. I done preached myself happy, Keith. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You know what? Let me show y'all something. Look at me. Look at me. Look at this kid. This is what real faith looks like. No. Hear me for a minute. When you're able to rest in the storm, that's faith. That's faith. You see that? He's resting. And I know I didn't create a storm in here. That's faith. You see, God wants to take us from faith to faith, that he could work through us and reveal himself. But in our faith, the only way it's going to have power is we got to get back to putting God first. There is no formula. There is no more seminars. I don't need no more talk shows. I don't need no more tracks. I'm telling you, the answer is we have to literally get back to putting God first. Amen? Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Y'all play something for me softly, would you? This is the time that we set aside for worship. Because we believe giving is worship. Giving is a heart issue. And I know that you've been to some churches and the preacher tells you what to give. If the preacher tells you what to give, he ought to be in charge of your return. Jack, I tell you, we don't beg here. Giving is a heart issue. But let me share the word of God with you. Because I've lived my life banking on the word, sold out. Everything that I have, the anointing, the joy, the peace, the resources, it's only because I trusted God. That's it. That's it. Keith, I would not have flew over 50 states to get dropped off in Prescott to shout about the word of God if it did not work, if he was not true. There's no way I would. I like y'all, but not. Come on, Jacob. You're a good barber, but not that, you know. Come on. I would not do it if it wasn't true. Because I'm just, can we be real? Because I was okay sinner. I could have went back. But the word of God will not fail. Tyra, look what the word says. Let's just go to the word, the Bible. The Bible says, watch this, guys. If you sow sparingly, in 2 Corinthians 6:9-6, it says, if you sow sparingly, you reap sparingly. Now, I'm not, we don't beg at Mount Zion, Jacob. I'll tell you what the word says. If you praying a little, then you get back a little. If you're serving a little, you get back a little. If you're giving a little, you get back a little. God says, but then he says, but if you sow bountifully, you reap bountifully. Am I right about it, Miss Hanson? If you praying a lot, God is listening a lot. If you're serving a lot, God is blessing a lot. If you're giving a lot, God is blessing bountifully. Listen, we sitting in here, and God is saying to me and you, you're not waiting on me. I'm waiting on you. My word has already been established. I got to follow my word. You just got to get in line and put God first. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 9:6, look what it says. It says, give as you have decided in your heart. Giving is a heart issue because the kingdom of God is in our heart now. That's where the Garden of Eden is. That's where you establish your wheat or your tare. So when your heart lines up with the will of God and you are obedient, God will bless your socks off. Bless your socks off. Blow your mind. Why don't you trust God today? If you believe God's word, let me hear you when I say, it's time to give, Mount Zion. Wait. I got Jacob in here. And that's how y'all gonna do? Don't y'all embarrass me in here. I said it's time to give, Mount Zion. Yeah. Go ahead, guys. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love.
Is there anybody in here today? Let me tell you what I'm talking about when I say in love with Jesus. Do you remember, anybody in here, remember the first dance with the person you just so in love with? You remember that first dance? When you danced with that person you were so in love with. Come on, somebody. Y'all act like, y'all come on. That's the kind of love I'm talking about with Jesus. When you fall in love with Jesus like that, this is what happens, Keith. When you really, really in love with Jesus, no matter what happens, you can rest because you know the love of your life is on your side. Come on, somebody. Now, Keith is real Mary, very Mary. So there are problems that come about in his life that he don't feel that bad because he know that he got his wife on his side. Take that and multiply it times 10 and fall in love. Is there anybody in here in love with Jesus? I'm talking about really, really in love with Jesus.
Protected.
Ooh, come on, somebody.
In his arms, never did.
I never ever in the service or
Bible study. No matter how good we preach, sometimes we may preach the paint off the walls, and I do sometimes. But if you don't give them opportunity, Jesus, you ain't done nothing. Will there be one in here today that does not know Jesus? Is there one in here today that does not know Jesus? If you don't know the love that some of us feeling right now, I'm talking about that kind of love that you are never, ever, ever alone. Will there be one in here today that does not know Jesus? When I was praying about the altar call today, because I allowed Jesus to rule the service. So I was praying about altar call today. And God said, don't lay hands on one person. Watch this. He placed it on my heart. Watch this. That some of us are in danger of missing what God has for us in 2021. Because there are some of us in here, and this is not about condemnation, because if God is speaking to you, I guarantee you he's going to bless you today. But some of us in here are walking in disobedience. I got to be real. God said some of us are walking in anger. God said some of us are walking in unforgiveness. God said some of us are walking being judgmental. God said some of us in here are walking in depression. God said some of us in here are walking in anxiety. Real for a minute. God said some of us in here are walking in hopelessness. God said some of us are walking in darkness. Let me tell you what darkness is. It's when you've been held captive to a sin and you don't want to tell anybody and you're ashamed to go to God to repent. The devil just holds you in the dark. There is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. This is not about condemnation. I'm trying to help us. Some of us are walking in fear. Some of us are struggling with pride. Come on, come on, come on, stay with me. This is real. God is getting ready to move in this place. The Holy Ghost is here. Some of us are walking in stubbornness. Some of us are walking in pity. Some of us are walking worried. Some of us are walking with affliction. But God told me that this Sunday morning, that if any of those things are taking place, or maybe it's something else, God said for me to tell you that those emotions are too loud for you to hear the Holy Spirit guiding you to position for an outpour of the Holy Ghost and a blessing on your life in 2021. So God told me, don't lay hands on nobody today in the altar. God says for me to open up the altar. And if any of that is you, I need you to come to the altar and drop it here. And don't pick it back up. Today is the day for deliverance. Don't mess around, because God is healing and delivering today. I want you to come today and drop it off. Come now, because it is hindering you from walking in the blessing of 2021.
Falling in love.
Today is the day. You need to release it. Yes, ma'am. Today is the day. Yes, ma'am. God's going to bless you today. Today is the day. There is deliverance in this altar. There's freedom in this altar. There's blessing in this altar. Today is the day. Woo! God said, cast your cares on me, because I care. I don't want anybody else to leave with what they drop off today. God, there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. God doesn't care where we've been. He doesn't care what happened yesterday. He's concerned where we're at now and where he's trying to get us to. That's why he's speaking to us now. God's saying, if you give it to me right now, you walk away in freedom. If you give it to me right now and leave it at this altar, you're debt free. You're free. You're delivered and you're healed today in this altar. I'm telling you what the word of God is saying to me. Today is the day. Nobody has to touch you. You don't have to tell anybody. God already knows. When you leave it here. We'll sweep it up when you're gone. But today is the day. Woo. Whatever it is, you need to give it to God today, because God is trying to bless the body of Christ in 2021.
Falling in love with Jesus.
Tell you what, watch this. Watch this. There are a few people still in their seat. So if that's you, I want you to ball it up like this and throw it up here. Get it up here. Get it off you. Today's the day. God is healing. God is healing today. Today. Right here. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Drop it off, sir. Glory to God. Hallelujah. 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 Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Leave it right there. God knows what it is. Sing softly, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Luke, come here. Good man.
With Jesus.
Oh my gosh. powerful service. Glory be to God.
Falling in
I just love you guys. I love you. And I pray right now that God would hide his word in our heart, that we would not sin against God. I pray that you leave here today fully committed to putting God first, that you would be in position for the power and the blessing that has been commanded on our lives in 2021. But we got to put God first. This is our year, but we're going to have to put God first. Do you believe it today? Give God glory. Woo. Eric, pray us out. Guys, I want you to leave today knowing that our path has already been established. We are widows. All we got to do is make the decision to put God first. The path has already been prepared. Amen? God bless you. I'll see you next Sunday. Praise God. Praise God.